Every Irish wolfhound fancier knows the story about the origin of the breed. In 1859, Captain Graham, a Scot, born in 1833, decided to reinstate the Irish wolfhound. For this, according to Graham, dogs were used which still resembled an enormous, strong, rough-coated sighthound which had existed in the past. These dogs were crossbred with, in example, the borzoi, the Tibet dog, and the deerhound. After the breed had been re-established, it was spread all over the globe quite quickly. Soon afterwards, all the stud books were closed, which resulted in the overall opinion that only one breed type was the correct one. All breeders strived for this one type by performing line and inbreeding, and dogs which didn't live up to this standard were excluded from the gene pool. The diversity of genes from which the breed was created soon became highly uniform. Showing and winning points soon became of the utmost importance, and the big winners, mostly males, the so-called matador males, were used beyond boundaries. Many thought to be of service to the breed by doing so, unaware of the fact that they were rapidly narrowing the gene pool with all devastating consequences as a result. Mankind slowly changed from breeder to a copy machine. The huge, strong sighthound which used to hunt in a distant past was recreated to serve as an attractive show dog, with negative results for the breed. The beauty of the breed for sure was perfected, but resulted in the loss of the so needed genetic diversity. So, where did it go wrong? Every living creature consists of cells. When we are taking a close look at the cell, we notice the nucleus in which the DNA is located. The DNA carries the hereditary characteristics. Chromosomes are built from this DNA. A dog has 39 pairs of chromosomes. Each chromosome is composed of half the genetic material of the mother and half of the genetic material of the father. Half a chromosome is called a haploid, and in mammals these only appear in reproductive cells. A haploid contains a collection of cell combinations which is half of the genetic material of a dog. The egg cell of the female and the sperm cell of the male each contain a haploid. These two haploids together determine the haplotypes of the offspring. A haplotype is formed after the merging of the haploids of the parents. The combination possibilities of haploids in a healthy population is diverse. This is what it is all about. Breeding for as much uniformity as possible in pedigree dogs results in a limited number of haploids. The limitation of the number of haploids, the genetic diversity of a breed, causes serious problems to appear. A good example is poor functioning of the immune system. A well-functioning immune system will detect and destroy intruders. A poor functioning immune system will attack the body's own healthy cells. The immune system is passed on as one group which does not split. The immune system is located in the reproductive cells and therefore they are also haploids. This system is a very complicated system which is controlled by a group of closely located genes called the major histocompatibility complex, or MHC. MHC genes are unique because they differ greatly from each other. Sometimes they exist of more than 100 different shapes and mutate easily. This system is highly complex compared to other biological systems. The MHC system must be capable of recognizing a wide variety of infections. Just a small amount of genes and its variety, alleles, will not be capable of properly defending the body. By inbreeding, chances are higher that each parent passes on the same MHC system to their offspring, which results in decreased defending possibilities. The Grouchy Project examines the inheritance of chiara malformation and searing coma ilia, CMSM. CM is a malformation of the skull which appears in brachycephalic dogs, which can result in SM. This project is supervised by Claire Rusbridge, CMSM specialist, and Penny Noller, researcher. On June 21, 2012, five crossbred babies were born. The intermediate inheritance was clearly seen at birth by the shape of the skulls. If we take a closer look at the parents, we see that the differences in type of dogs are big. The father has normal length of legs and the mother is short-legged. The mother is a bit stronger in bone and muscle development. The mother is longer in body and has upright ears. The father is short-bodied and has somewhat semi-erect ears. The X-ray pictures show the big differences in skulls. The father, a griffon, is brachycephalic, the mother, an Australian terrier, is mesetecephalic, and the Irish wolfhound is dolichocephalic. Brachycephaly is divided into groups. A Cavalier King Charles Spaniel is a brachycephalic breed, and a griffon is an extreme brachycephalic breed. There is an almost total lack of muzzle, and the skull is short and high. We can safely say that a cross between a griffon and an Australian terrier, specifically when it comes to the skulls, is extreme. What is intermediate mode of inheritance? Like we see here, a jolly long blue cube entered into a relationship with a spirited short blue cube. According to intermediate mode of inheritance, their offspring will never be as long as long blue cube, and never be as short blue cube. They will all be somewhere in between. This is clearly shown in the Grouchy F1 generation. These dogs all resemble each other, but all different in length of muzzle, back and legs, as shown in these photos, though none of them resembles one or the other parent. A hopeless result, many will think, and a total loss of the desired type. We will get back to this later. When looking back at the haplotype, we see that we have created a brand new one in these grouses. This new haplotype is the reason why the grousey looks as it does. The meaning of crossbreeding is, of course, breeding back to the desired type. To do this the right way, we use a good specimen of the breed, but preferably, of course, of a different bloodline which is used to crossbreed. In case we start inbreeding on the F1 generation, we will soon be back where we started. Just one outcross with another breed is never enough. This should be done at bigger scale, preferably with several different breeds. It can be decided to crossbreed every so many generations to give new impulses to the breed, which increase the genetic diversity. Solving problems in a population will only succeed by increasing the genetic diversity. It is better not just to think about one's own dogs, but about the breed in general. Just one breeder alone won't be able to improve a breed health-wise. This can only be done when breeders cooperate. Thinking my line has to be left behind and needs to make place for the slogan my breed. The time of universal close cooperation by breeders has arrived if we want to save our breeds.